A warm good evening to one and all present here.
Hope all are safe and healthy in this pandemic. It is a big day for all of us as our Civil Engineering Association is being inaugurated. A pearl is worthless as long as it is in its shell. CEA Association has now come forward to bring out all the technical skills of the students. To make something big, energetic and enthusiastic, we surely need a good start. Now, I request our head of the department, Professor R. Kumuda, to deliver the welcome address.
Thank you. A pleasant good evening to all of you. I'm very happy to welcome you all for this inaugural function of our Civil Engineering Association. And we are very fortunate enough to have Dr. Mahendra Kumar Madhavan of IIT Hyderabad today with us to witness this program. So on behalf of all the students and faculty members present here, I give a warm welcome to Dr. Mahendra Kumar Madhavan for this inauguration. And as you know, this Civil Engineering Association is a platform in which the students will get an opportunity to expose their talents, especially they can develop their organizing skills, and team working skills, communication skills, and above all, technical skills. So we have formed this association and with office bearers also. And in this occasion, I'd like to add few things like this association is purely a technical association. So I would suggest the office bearers of this association to focus more on technical events because we have other forums in our SBCE to showcase the other skills and talents, whereas this Civil Engineering Association is purely a technical thing in which you can develop your technical skills as well. So, and also I would like to congratulate the students who are going to take the responsibility as office bearers in various portfolios like the president, secretary, treasurer and other executive members. So I congratulate them, and also I want them to involve themselves more in the developing this association in terms of organizing more events related to technical aspects. And I wish this association a great success, and I hope definitely this year is going to be a successful year for us in terms of organizing more programs through the Civil Engineering Association. So once again, I welcome you all for this program, and my special thanks to Dr. Mahendra Kumar Madhavan for accepting this invitation in a very short notice. In fact, we were discussing for a long time for a program, but still due to many reasons and circumstances, we are not able to make it. But still, today we are very fortunate to have him in this forum, especially to inaugurate this program. So I welcome once again Dr. Mahendra Kumar Madhavan, and also I welcome all the faculty members and also the association coordinators, Mr. Harishwaran and Mr. Kalaiwanan, and also all the student members, and also the office bearers who is going to take the responsibility for this academic year, for this event. So I wish this program a great success. So I don't want to take much time, and now I request Mr. Harishwaran to take over the session.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
It's my immense pleasure to introduce the Civil Engineering Association office bearer for the academic year 2021 here. I would like to introduce the office bearer for this academic year through the screen. Mr. Vikas, the president of CEA from final year. Mr. Shanmugam, treasurer from final year. Mr. Abhishek Murli, general secretary from third year. Ms. Arshia, joint secretary from second year. Ms. Monisha, senior executive member from third year. Mr. Naveen, senior executive member from third year. Mr. Vijay, senior executive member from third year. Ms. Sharada Lakshmi, senior executive member from third year. Ms. Jenny Shah, senior executive member from second year. Ms. Harshavardhani, junior executive member from second year. Ms. Neha, junior executive member from second year. Mr. Lalit Kumar, junior executive member from second year. On behalf of our Department of Civil Engineering, I congratulate all the office bearer. Thanks for the opportunity. It's over to Ms. Neha.
Thank you, sir. Now I invite the association staff in charge, Mr. R. Kalevanan, sir, to introduce our chief guest.
So good evening all. So thank you, Neha, for the opportunity. So I take an immense pleasure to introduce the guest of the day, Professor Mahendra Kumar Madhavan. Sir completed his bachelor's degree in civil engineering from College of Engineering, Dindi, Anna University, Chennai. He pursued his master's in civil engineering from National University of Singapore. He did his PhD in University of Alabama at Birmingham, United States of America. He's also a registered professional engineer licensed by Alabama States, USA. Professor Mahendra Kumar Madhavan has received many honors and awards. To mention a few, who's who among students in American universities and colleges in the year 2005. Sir was nominated thrice for Academic Excellence Award at University of Alabama, Birmingham during the year 2003 to 2005. And he was also a recipient of Outstanding Achievement Award, UAB Outstanding Achievement Award, and many more. Regarding his work experience, sir started his career as a research scholar at National University of Singapore from 1998 to 2000. And then sir worked as a graduate research assistant in the University of Alabama, Birmingham, and Pennsylvania State University, State College, USA. And sir joined in Alabama Power Company, Birmingham, as a structural engineer. He worked there for 7 years. Then in May 2012, he joined in Indian Institute of Technology, Hyderabad, joined as assistant professor. Then currently now sir working as associate professor in Indian Institute of Technology, Hyderabad. Professor Mahendra Kumar Madhavan has been actively involved in a lot of professional activities. To list a few, it's a part of International Journal Editorial Board and Journal of Structures, the Institution of Structural Engineers. He's also a voting member in the Coder Committee of ASE Structural Engineering Institute, at the Technical Administrative Committee on Metals. He has been active a journal reviewer for many international journals, which includes Journal of Structural Engineering, Journal of Bridge Engineering, Journal of Composite for Construction, so all under American Society of Civil Engineers, a Journal of Institution Engineers, and many more in the list. Sir holds membership in international professional bodies, include a member of American Society of Civil Engineers, and member of a Structural Steel Research Council, and few more. Professor Mahendra Kumar Madhavan has published many papers in international journals, which are peer reviewed, and sir published 40 plus research works in international conference proceedings. So with this, thank you. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Now I happily invite our chief guest speaker, Dr. Mahendra Kumar Madhavan, to enlighten us with knowledge and address the gathering. Sir, you can share your screen.
Okay. Good evening, everyone, one and all. First, I would like to apologize for not able to keep up my commitment at 2:30 p.m. beyond my control. There was a power shutdown due to some flash floods here at Telangana, Hyderabad. And because of this, the substation at IIT Hyderabad had to be shut down, and now the power has come. So very sorry for that. Thank you for Kumuda Madam for giving me this great opportunity to inaugurate this this Civil Engineering Association. This institute that Madam you are currently working is one of the best institutes in Tamil Nadu. I know for a fact, because when I was doing my when I was about to join engineering colleges, this was one of the prominent engineering colleges that was given at that time. If I have to choose a private engineering college at the time, SVCS was one in the list. Okay, and so it has a long history and tradition, and I would like to, for all of you, to keep that long history and tradition keep continuing. One suggestion that I would like to give to all the students before I start my presentation is that civil engineering is a very great field. Okay, so don't look for instant gains in civil engineering. Civil engineering is more like a test match. Okay, it's not a 2020 game, it's more like a test match. So I kindly request you to stay in the field for longer period of time. Okay, and as a consequence, what you need to do is to at least prepare for GATE, the GATE exam, and everyone in your class should write GATE exam and at least do a master's degree. It may be in structures, it may be in water resources, transportation, environmental, geotechnical, whatever may be your field of passion in civil engineering, but don't hesitate to do a master's degree. It is utmost importance given the current competition that we have. Okay, so that would make sure that you are actually a skilled person, in a specialized person in one particular field of civil engineering, which is utmost essential for you to play the game in the long run. Okay, with this one, I would like to start my presentation here. Thank you very much for the rosy introduction by the faculty member, Kalivanan, I believe. Thank you so much. And let me start my presentation on parallel flange beams. Okay, anybody know what is a parallel flange beam? Have you heard the term parallel flange beam? Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, anyone can, faculty at least can respond. Anybody have heard the term parallel flange beams? Okay, this term, I will tell you what, this is a term that I heard it way back in 2013. When I came back from US, I joined a faculty at IIT Hyderabad in 2012. So I got a phone call from a person from Jindal Steel asking me to give a presentation on parallel flange beams. And I didn't know what parallel flange beam was. And then it was after a lot of digging that I realized that the Indian steel I sections have a tapered flange compared to the one that is used globally, and that is a parallel flange beam. So I started digging into that. Although I worked for several years, I did not notice that the flanges were exactly parallel, but when it came to India, it was actually a tapered one. So I wanted to know more about it, and hence this presentation. Okay, so before we go to that, I'd like to give a general philosophy of introduction. Okay, usually steel structure, my expertise in steel structures, so I'll just give you a few tips on steel structures. Basically, the performance of steel structures in high seismic areas depends on several factors. One is the stability of structures, another is the material strength, and then there is the third one called ductility of individual sections and the connections. These are some of the basic criteria that is necessary for an in-depth understanding of steel structures. By stability of structures, we are actually talking about members that are subjected to compression. Maybe it can be in the form of axial compression, or it can be in the form of a flexural compression, shear compression due to shear as a result. So it is very important that we ensure that the structure is stable. So that comes under the stability of structures. The next one is the material strength. So we also need to make sure that it has a very good quality, high quality yield strength. And the third one is the ductility of the sections, so its ability to deform for a longer period of time, or the rotation capacity is very high. And the fourth one usually is the connections. So whether it's a welded connection, bolted connection, okay, how is it, a bolt with the regular bolts, or is it a bolt with high strength bolts? So many factors are there for connections. So these are several factors that decide the performance of a steel structure in high seismic areas. Okay, so the basic philosophy is, our objective is to prevent brittle type of failure and forcing ductile action. That is one of the key philosophy behind using steel structures. And common design exercise is basically a strong column and a weak beam method. We almost always want a strong column and we want a weak beam, simply because if a column fails, the entire structure fails. Whereas when a beam fails, the failure is localized, and so something can be done in terms of repair and retrofitting. And the beam column connections, joints are to be stronger than the beam. So the connection should be stronger than the beam, which is obvious, because you don't want the failure to happen at the connection, because when a failure happens at a connection, it's not just one member that fails, the entire members that are connected to the connection will fail. And more importantly, the columns are to be stronger than the beams, that is correct. But much more important is that the column base connections, which is the what they call base plate connection, should be stronger than the column. So in terms of order of priority, the most important is the column base plate connection should be stronger. Okay, as you can see here, let me just use this laser pointer here. So column base plate connections has to be the fundamental one that we need to look at. It should not fail at any reason. Then the column should not fail. Then the beam column connection should not fail. And the one that can be permitted to fail in case of an emergency is beam. So which should not happen is failure in base column-based connection, but can happen is beam. Okay, so now let's come back. This is a general intro. Now let's come back the comparison between Indian standard beams versus parallel flange beams. Okay. Before we go there, let's talk about what are the defects in existing tapered Indian tapered structural steel sections. Okay, so this is our rolled steel beams and columns, and you can see that, you know, there is a taper here. It is not straight. The thickness is very low at the edges. Okay, and then when it comes closer to the stem of the section, then it is thicker, right? So there is a variation. This variation is called tapering, and same thing for the bottom also. And this you can see even for the channels. So there is a tapering that is taking place. Okay, this is something that you will find only in Indian sections. Nowhere else in the world that you will find this kind of tapered sections at all. Okay, period. This I can tell it for certainty. So what are the disadvantages of tapered flange sections? First and foremost, they're more prone to connection failures. Okay, tapered are more prone to connection failures. There will be a picture that I will show in the next one or two slides. You will be able to understand why I'm telling that. Next one is, and the small flange sections require longer connection because it allows only single bolt on either side. This again, I will share it with you at the end of the slide, what exactly it is. Because when you connect two I sections, for example, there should be some sufficient space to put the bolts. Okay, if there are not sufficient space, then you have to make the connections longer. So if the members are tapered like this, you will not be able to put, say, two bolts here at this one side of the flange and two bolts. Rather, you may be ending up putting one bolt here and one bolt here. But which means that as you do the calculations, the number of bolts is 16 or something like that, then you have to have a longer flange or the splice length, which is undesirable because the effectiveness of the connection actually decreases with increase in the splice plate. Okay, that is another thing. And usually it has a lesser load capacity compared to equal parallel flange sections. So this is a tapered flange. In a minute, I will show you what a parallel flange is. But this tapered flange section actually has lesser load carrying capacity compared to parallel flange sections for the same weight. You don't change the weight. The weight remains the same, but it will actually have a lesser load carrying capacity simply because the distribution of the mass is not high here, but in the parallel flange, the distribution will be very good. Hence, there is an increase in the I. If there is an increase in the I, then the load carrying capacity increases because everything depends upon your moment of inertia, right? And then this also requires tapered washers. So if you're using a bolted connection, for example, here, your washers cannot be uniform thickness. It has to be tapered because it should have a proper, fit up. If it needs a proper fit up, then you may have to choose a tapered, okay, washers, which is very tough. The reasons I'll tell you. And this results in loss in efficiency. Okay, because you have tapered washers, what happens is that you may have to make sure that it is tapered properly, which means that you have to spend more time, manpower, to check that whether it has been properly placed at that location. And then this also increases the risk of the project due to improper seating of the bolts or the washers. Because if it is not properly seated, the connections are not good. If the connections are not good, the failure actually happens. Okay, usually what happens is that the member is as good as his connection. The weakest link in any structure is the connection. So if you don't design your connections properly, that is exactly where failure will occur. So you need to make sure that your reliability of the project increases by reducing the risk, and the reduction in risk has to be taken care of. But because of this tapered washers, there will be an issue associated with that. You will understand more once I show some pictures. And then there is also something called B by T ratio. Okay, anybody who's working in steel design will know that B by T is the slenderness ratio of the plate. Okay, if a plate has to be classified as plastic, compact, semi-compact and slender, those are the four section classifications that are available in IS 800. Okay, so what is the difference between plastic, compact, semi-compact and slender? It is simply the difference between 24 karat gold, 22 karat gold, and 18 karat gold, and something that is aluminium or copper. What is that I'm trying to say here? So if you have a plastic section, the plastic section will achieve failure due to yielding, and it also gives you enormous amount of moment rotation. So if you're going to build any structure in, say, zone 5 seismic in India, which is basically the northeastern part of India, the 7 states, right? The Assam, Meghalaya, you know, Manipur, Tripura, things like that. Those states are highly seismic. So it requires any structure to be seismically safe. In such situations, you need to have a lot of rotation capacity. So in order to have a lot of rotation capacity, your BBT ratio should be very small. Okay, so if your BBT ratio is very small, then you classify it as plastic. If it is slightly bigger BBT ratio, you know, then you call it as compact. There is no difference between plastic and compact in terms of moment carrying capacity. Okay, plastic and compact, most of them achieve the yield moment. The only difference is in the deformation capacity. The plastic will have a lot of deformation after attaining the plastic moment, whereas your compact sections will not have a lot of deformation capacity, but still it will achieve the moment capacity. So plastic and compact are covered. The next one is semi-compact. Semi-compact will not attain the plastic moment capacity, but it will reach the yield. It will reach the yield, but then it will fail after that. So it will reach yield. So that is not plastic moment, that is yield moment. So it will achieve yield moment. The fourth one is your slender cross sections, which will fail due to buckling. So once it reaches the buckling capacity or critical buckling load, it will suddenly drop. So that is why I told that it can be classified into four classifications as per Indian standard IS 800. It is called plastic, compact, semi-compact, and slender. So if you want to understand that, it is 24 karat gold, 22 karat gold, 18 karat gold, which is used in the US, and then you have, it's not at all gold, it's copper or something else. So those are the four classifications if you want to understand what it is. So why am I talking about all that stuff? Because all this classification of plastic, compact, semi-compact, and slender is based on your BBT ratio. If the BBT ratio, the width to thickness is the BBT ratio. Here B represents not the width of the flange, one half of the width of the flange here, because it is from this unsupported end to the supported point. So from this point is your D. Okay. So when the BBT ratio is very low, then you call it plastic, and then slightly higher is compact. Next higher is semi-compact, and then it is very high, it is slender. But the problem here is it is very difficult to define BBT ratio because the T is varying here. The T, thickness T, which is an important parameter to define whether it is plastic, compact, semi-compact, or slender, actually varies from one end of the flange to other end of the flange, right? So here it is very thin. In the middle, it is sort of okay. And then when it comes to this one, it is very thick. So because of this change, should I take that T at the end, or should I take it at middle, or should I take it closer to the web? These are some of the challenges that are associated with the use of tapered flanges. And because of this, we are not able to properly arrive at the BBT ratio, which can be used for classifying the cross-section as plastic, compact, semi-compact, or slender. So that is what I have told here. You have to, thickness consideration, IS 800, you have to define the thickness of the flange somewhere so that the engineers can work out the properties and the mills know what they need to produce. Measuring or specifying the thickness at the middle of the flange is an arbitrary decision. So people, I have talked to many people, and this is what they say, we should take it at the center, but it is an arbitrary decision. Engineer must determine what thickness is appropriate for checks being done. In many instances, the average flange thickness is appropriate, for others it may not be. So this is somewhat of a tricky thing. Can I take this thickness here and the thickness here and take an average, or should I take to the middle and take a thickness here? Okay, so the code is not very clear about that, but still 80 to 90% of the steel construction in India is based on this tapered flanges. But this is your parallel flange section. You see the difference between this one and this one? The parallel flange is very clean, neat, nice. Okay, there is no variation in the thickness from this end of the flange to the center and goes here. okay, there is a nice uniform thickness, okay, compared to this one. Okay, so this is what I call it as a parallel flange, and this parallel flange will not have any of the disadvantages that I have mentioned so far in terms of bolting, in terms of thickness determination, in terms of no need for tapered washers. Okay, so many advantages are associated, not to mention that the load carrying capacity of the parallel flange section is much higher than the rolled sections for the same weight. If this is, say, for example, 40 kilograms, whatever it is, per 1 meter or 2 meters, whatever it is, if you do the same thing here for per unit weight, okay, for 1 meters, and for the unit weight for 1 meters, both are same, okay, you are actually getting a much, much better use of the material by using a parallel flange section. Okay, so whatever I told here has been shown in the form of a picture here. So the bolt shank bends. What is a shank? Anybody know what a shank is? Shank is the part when there is a bolt, when the bolt, in the bolt there will be a head is there, and then there will be a uniform place where there is no threads, and there will be a threaded portion, right? The place where there is no threads is called a shank. The bolt shank actually bends because now you have to put it in a slightly bent manner. And more importantly, okay, your ability to weld here at this location is very low because there is a small weld thickness. The weld thickness is based on the amount of space here. So if you have a very small location here because of the thinness of the material. So if you go to IS 800, you will find that the thickness of the weld that is permitted is based on the lesser thickness of the plate at the bottom and or the thickness of the material that we put on top, the minimum one that is governing, and that determines the weld thickness. Weld thickness is basically your throat thickness. So that throat thickness can be lesser simply because the flange is thin at this location, and that may mean that your weld length will be very long. Once the length of the weld or the connection is long, the effectiveness of the weld actually reduces. So that is something that you need to consider, and that is one of the difficulties associated with having a smaller flange at the edges. And more importantly, because of the BBT ratio is very high, because of the thickness is small, the BBT ratio is high, there could be possibility of local buckling that takes place at the edges due to reduced thickness. And more importantly, the alignment of the tapered washers is very difficult. This is the tapered washer. You can see that the thickness of the washer is higher here and then it is smaller here. And this alignment is very tough because many times these constructions take place not in the ground. It takes place 100 feet, 200 feet up in the air. And most of the times, somebody who has not got proper education will end up here doing this one. So he really doesn't care how the washers are put, and he may put this one upside down, and then there will be a gap at this location. The gap will mean that there is no proper bearing. Water could go inside and then it starts corroding, and then the bearing strength will be lost. And so there is a potential failure of the bolt if the tapered washers are not put in the proper direction. Okay, so this is what I meant by bolt shank, bending of bolt shank. Okay, because if it is not, because of this tapered thing, the bolt shank could bend like this. Okay, this is a tapered section, and the availability of weld thickness is very small because the thickness is tapered here compared to the one at the middle or at the edges. So these are some of the real problems. So I would like to go share with you a few series of photographs. This was taken at a famous structural engineering lab. Okay, and I could see that there are many issues associated with that. So this is the place where we are using a tapered flange. You can see that the thickness of the flanges here is small. The thickness is higher. It is tapered from this location down here. And see how they have put here. Okay, this is the washer that they have put on top of that. It's a nut, but they are not properly seated. Okay, so this is the column here, tapered I section and tapered channel section here, beam. Okay, this is another view. I'll show you more series of views. Okay, you see that the bolt is not straight here. It is slightly tilted at this location because it is not properly seated. It's very difficult to work with tapered section connections. Okay, and this gives another picture of that same. And this is clearly shows that the bolts are not properly seated. It is not proper. Bearing is not proper here at this location. And since there is a gap here at this location, so because of this, bearing strength will be lost, and in this gap, God forbidden, anything could happen, moisture enters or other things happen at this location, then it's going to corrode and get affected very soon. And because of proper less tightening, you can see a gap here also. This is a huge gap. Okay, so the bolt is not going to do much of the work. The work happens only when you properly tighten it at this location with zero gap at this location. And this gap actually exceeds the limits of tolerance. I mean, obviously, if it is so easy to find out by naked eye, then it actually exceeds the tolerance. And this again, this you can see that the tilted one here, and you can see that this bolt is actually new. You know, it is not been coated compared to this bolt. So you see there is a corrosion here at this location. So out of curiosity, when I asked that person why this bolt is new, they told that the bolt actually had failed previously and they have replaced it with the new bolt. So that is a good indication that the tapered sections are not easy to work with in terms of bolted connections because of the taper. Okay, this is another location here, another location here. Okay, so I don't want to go deep into this one. It shows the gap here is too high. This is not, the gap should be something like this, but the gap here is too high. Okay, what if the bolt fails? Another thing that also is a problem here is that because of this one, there is a difficulty to put a transverse stiffness. Sometimes there may be a location where there is a sudden increase in load or a point out at that location, and you may have to weld a transverse stiffener in the beams. When you have to weld a transverse stiffener, what happens is that because of the slope, then you may have to measure or, you know, exactly this one, and then you cut it and weld it, and then you have to grind it at this location. So a lot of work is associated, and it's to fit an exact tapered slope. Okay, so that is again a difficulty associated with tapered flanges. On the contrast, what are the advantages of parallel flange structural steel sections? Okay, the parallel flange structural steel sections, okay, this is how it is. Problems related to considering the problems related with erection and performance of tapered flange sections, hot rolled steel sections with parallel flanges with quadrangular toes and curvatures at the joint of the flange and web are now step by step being produced in India. It is true that it is being produced in India, but unfortunately it is not being utilized to the level that we would expect it to be. And Bureau of Indian Standards IS-12778 has come up with parallel flange, but still there are some issues associated with that. Mainly the mother document IS-800 as of today does not refer to IS-12778. So that is a problem. So many people don't know that there is a separate code IS-12778 that is available specifically for designing parallel flange sections. On top of that, many of the government projects that people involve, there is a requirement that the steel should be purchased from certain steel companies, say SAIL, okay, government steel companies, SAIL, Vizag Steel, Rashtriya Ispat Nigam Limited, it is called RINL. So these are the companies, but many of these companies are yet to full-fledgedly produce parallel flange sections, so they are only producing tapered flanges, and then the government projects don't have a choice other than to purchase the tapered flange sections, and then that gives us issues associated with bolting, connection, okay, and the progress is much slower because of the use of tapered flange sections. Okay, let's compare IS-808. What is IS-808? IS-808 is the section that produces parallel flanges. And IS-12778 is the section that produces, this IS-808 is for tapered flanges and IS-12778 is for parallel flanges. So this is how it looks like. So IS-808, right? So this is dimensions of hot rolled steel beams, column, channel, angle sections. This is for IS-12778, hot rolled parallel flange steel sections for beams, columns, bearing and dimensions and section properties. So design properties, how are they superior? So these are some of the parallel flanges that are available in our code. So you can see that the parallel flange sections for the same depth, NPB 200 means the depth of the member is 200. Okay, 200 means it is not exactly 200 mm, it is somewhere in the neighborhood. So if it is NPB 200 with mass 18.42 and cross section it is this, the depth is 197. Here NPB 200, 22.36, the depth is 200 here. This 200 here, the 200 here, 207, 200 here is 210. So there is a slight increase or decrease for this NPB 200, but you can see that there is a change in the mass. So it goes from 18 kilograms per meter to say 48 kilograms per meter. You understand the point I'm saying? So, but whereas when you look at Indian standard section ISMB, say 300, it's okay. You have only one section. Okay, there is no other sections that is comparable. So whether when you want any member with the depth of 300, you should use only ISMB 300 with 46. So at some locations, you may not need 46. You may need only 25 kilograms per meter, and that moment of inertia is sufficient for you to say do the job. But because of this restriction of providing only one section for the depth of 300, you're abusing or not using the material wisely. Here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So for one depth, you have 9 choices. So if you really want a member which has to do a lot more work, then you can do moment of inertia, you can do, we can increase this mass here and the cross-section area increases, and obviously there will be an increase in moment of inertia compared to this one. So this is the beauty about the parallel fan sections compared to our Indian standard steel sections. Why the world has shifted to parallel flange beams? That is something that we have to do. And in the process of doing many things, I also had a discussion with the American Iron and Steel Institute to understand properly why parallel flange beams are more productive and why some still use tapered flange beams. Okay, and this is the verbatim he told. So in 1896, this is a history of structural steel sections. In 1896, the Association of American Steel Manufacturers standardized LC angle sections, channel section, I-shape, now what we call as S-shapes. And S-shapes were used because that was what could be produced with available materials. This S-shape is basically what we are using currently as tapered flanges. So this was in use in 1896. So we are in 2020. So you should understand where we are and where Americans are. Okay. The first production wide flange beams, W shapes, were produced in 1902 in a place called Luxembourg. You know Luxembourg? Luxembourg is a small country near Greece. Okay, it's in Europe, using a process developed by an American called Henry Gray. So in 1906, Bethlehem Steel is currently in the state of Pennsylvania, US. And Bethlehem Steel was the leader for much, much longer period of time. And they used to give a lot of steel sections to the nearby university, Lehigh. Lehigh is the great university there, which is focused on steel structures. And they used to provide, Bethlehem Steel used to provide a lot of steel sections for that university to do research. Okay, so licensed the process and also began producing wide flange shapes. So this wide flange shapes, what we call W shapes here in the US, W shapes, what we call as parallel flange beams, were produced in 1902. And W shapes are more efficient than A shapes because they put more area further from the neutral axis. So because the more area is away from the neutral axis, the effectiveness of the section is high because we have more moment of inertia. But so after the 1920s, wide flange shapes quickly dominated the market both in the US and the Britain. Okay, and this is verbatim his words. I realize none of this explains why A-shapes might still be found in more common use in some parts of the world and in less common use in other parts. I suspect there are a whole lot of reasons, economic, regulatory, okay, etc. For the instance, the grain mill at Methlehem are in use for 60 years, probably longer. It takes a lot of money to build a mill. So it is probably a difficult decision to switch products and process. And he's absolutely right. Because most of the steel plants that we have, Bokaro, okay, and other places, were established by the Russians as soon as we got independence. So Nehru did a lot of work at that time to bring in a lot of revolution. And the Russians came and established that. But the technology that the Russians had at the time were not parallel flange beams. They were actually tapered flange beams. And since once the technology is established, you pour close to 10,000 crores for a steel mill to operate. It's called an integrated steel manufacturing plant. So everything from raw materials to final finished product takes place there. That is called a primary steel, where the chemistry and the geometry and all other parameters, mechanical properties are very much controlled in a control, and you get a very good quality product. That is why when you build a house, you should purchase steel from a primary producer. Say, for example, Tata Steel, there is Tata Tiscon is there for reinforced concrete. I'm just telling you, Tata Tiscon or JSPL Panther or JSW Neo. These are some of the steel if you should use. So don't go for a secondary producer because your house is your greatest investment in your lifetime. So please make sure that when you are building a house, you do make sure that you produce a good, put a very good quality product, because better ingredients is your if you put good input and your structure will be very good. Okay, so where was I? So since we had established a lot of things, we are only still producing. So here in 2015, this was the work I done at 2015, 75% of steel construction still in tapered flanges. So a lot of the benefits available for parallel flange beams. So when we wanted to study ISMB versus equivalent parallel flange sections, this is what we found out. So this is a step-by-step design of actually loaded columns as per IS 800. So when you do with IS 800, you have to look for buckling classification A, B, C, D. So this is a column with a length of 5 meters, 5,000 mm. This is an I section, MPB 200, 42.47 kilogram per meter. So the cross section area is this, FY is 250 MPa steel. We do the buckling classification, thickness is this, imperfection factor, slenderness, everything. When we do the design, this is, we should not exceed 180 is the maximum slenderness that we have to have. So we have this non-dimensional slenderness ratio in the ZZ major axis and minor axis. Things like that. This is how we calculate your compressive strength. Okay, this is V is the reduction factor. And then we size the reduction factor. Then we get the load as 485.7 kilonewton. So this is what we get. Okay, we get 485.7 kilonewton for using this parallel flange. So when we do this tapered flanges, okay, for the same effective length, okay, 5,000, 5,000. And this is 42.47 for parallel flange, and this is 46. So this is the equivalent that we can find. Okay, this is only 200. The depth is only 200. Here the depth is 300. You can see, okay, the same philosophy is used, except that the moment of inertia for this one is 4.86 into 10^6 mm/4. Here it is 9.16. Okay, so obviously there is twice the increase for a parallel flange sections, although the depth is 200. So you should also be surprised. The depth is 200, here the depth is 300, but still you have a much more higher moment of inertia because of the proper distribution of the geometry. And more importantly, you get less than close to half. Here you get 485.7 for parallel flange and you get 287.2. Okay. And for a member, that is almost the same. In fact, it is slightly higher, 46 kilogram per meter in 42. So the tonnage of steel actually is more or less the same, but the load carrying capacity is 287 versus 485. So that is a huge difference, that because of the change in geometry that we could get. And that is currently that we are not able to take advantage of. And one more important thing is, because this height is 200, you will get only 100 mm as the head space, you will get 100 mm increase. This 100 mm might be very small for people, for we think that 100 mm is nothing. But if you go to countries like Singapore, for example, this 100 mm is a great thing. Okay, so when I was a student at NUS, I used to live in an apartment, and the apartment looked funny. Initially, I couldn't figure out why it was. It looked a little bit smaller, and I felt like I was in a closed space, and I couldn't understand why. And then I realized that there is no ceiling fan. And all the fans were in the side. There were all the fans that were put on the wall. So there were wall-mounted fans, but there were no ceiling fans. And I understood why, because when you put a ceiling fan, then your height has to be at least 10 feet, right? So they smartly removed that ceiling fan, and then they might have reduced the height to 9 feet, and then they saved 1 feet. By saving 1 feet in each apartment, 10 apartments, 10 floors later, you'll get another apartment free. So this 100 mm, we may think it's very small, but if you talk to anybody whose land space is crunched, people, countries, they will surely understand the importance of this headroom. Okay, so these are some of the compressive design curves that I have produced, and you can see that almost always, you can see that this parallel flange sections have higher load carrying capacity compared to all the equivalent, okay, all, you know, with the, compared to this ISMB 300. So the compressive design curve, and then this is the actual difference. So if you look at it, ISMB 300, this is drawn to scale. There is 46 kilogram per meter. The load carrying capacity is 287.2. So you can see this shape versus this shape. Okay, the depth is now not 300, it is 205, and its width is 166, and this is MPB 400. The weight is also slightly lower, but the load carrying capacity of this one is much higher than this one. So obviously, we should quit using tapered flanges and start using parallel fine steel sections. And I did several stuff. The one that you see is for ISMB 300. You can see that 300 is one example that I took. But compared to 300, everything else is much better because the here also we went for 350. Even for 350, you can see that this NPB 350 and NPB 300 is much higher than this one. So what wherever you see that ISMB is the lowest curve here, and the NPB is the curve that gives you more strength, okay, design capacity. Again, here this ISMB 400 is here, and every other curve that you find out has higher, so higher load carrying capacity. And then I went to 450, I went for 500, I went for 550, still the same reason. I went for 600. Okay, even in 600, you can see that ISMB has the lower load carrying capacity compared to the other ones, NPB, the parallel flange. And I stopped at 600. Okay, anybody know why I stopped at 600? Just making sure that you're not sleeping.
The maximum depth available in India is 2600, sir.
Exactly. Who's this? Faculty student?
Yes, I'm Kalevan faculty, sir.
Fantastic. Okay, that's the maximum you have. You don't go beyond 600. So what do you do if you have to go beyond 600? Well, you make your own steel sections.
Built up sections.
Yes, exactly. You buy a plate, cut it, weld it, done. Right? So you go for built up sections. That is where plate girder comes into picture. So this ISMB 600 is, say, for example, is only 2 feet, right? If you think 300 mm is 1 feet, ISMB is only 2 feet depth. But if you have to go for a steel bridge, okay, and you have to use a steel girder, you have to go for 20 feet at least. So it means that it should be much, much higher, and then you don't have any rolled steel sections that deep. So you have to make your own steel sections. So what is any other point that provides superiority? Absolutely. Okay. This is what happens when you use a tapered flanges. When you use a tapered flanges, you can put only one bolt on one side, which means that the length of the connection is very long. Correct. Because the number of bolts should be the same. You calculate it based on the number of bolts, the average here, that and this, right? So 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16. So if you have 16 bolts, the length is 2 times longer. Whereas if you put it here with 2 bolts on either sides, you can accommodate the 16 bolts in a much smaller connection length. When you put it in much smaller connection length, the effectiveness of the connection is very high, because the bolts actually are the ones that are closer to the center where it is being connected are more active and slightly lesser active when it comes to the edges. Okay, but if the bolts are very far away from this point where it is getting connected, these bolts actually don't participate. You understand my point? These bolts are just sitting and sleeping. They are not participating. So if you want to increase the effectiveness of the bolts, you have to put it closer to the connection, and then you have to have a smaller connection length. Not to mention that the dead weight of the connection also increases if you have a longer connection length. Effectiveness is decreasing, dead weight is increasing. So that is a double blow when you use a tapered sections and you have parallel fan section, much effective. And most importantly, okay, you can take advantage of what is known as quote washers. So while I was working in the US, one fellow who looked like an uneducated person came and started, gave me a keychain. He gave a talk and he gave me a keychain which had this type of bolts here, this type of washers here. Okay, not a bolt washer. Okay, and he is very rich person now. Okay, he one day suddenly realized that there is a small opening in this location. So this is basically some kind of a curvature here, basically, and then it will be higher up here. I don't have this picture here. If you invert this one, there will be bumps at the top here. And so when you put the washers, and then you have a screw gun like this, a washer connecting here by mechanical connection, you have to ensure that it is flat. And then once it is flat, then you will have the required torque that is introduced. So a bolt is as effective as it is perfectly fit. But it's very difficult if you don't put some kind of a coloring material here, because we don't know whether the bolt is properly connected or not. So this person came up with the same washer. Instead of openings, he put some kind of a crayon. This is more like an orange crayon. It's very hard, actually. So when you apply the force here, say for example, if it is 30 kilonewton meter torque has to be applied, once the torque, required torque is applied, this washer will become flat and it will squirt all the crayon type coloring material will come outside. So once it is coming outside, you know that the bolt is properly placed in position. Okay, so this gives a lot of confidence to the quality control engineer, and then the job of that person is also easy because based on the squirt location and the manner in which it is squirting, okay, you can understand whether it has been properly connected or not. Okay, so this person who, you know, had an idea and now is a big person, big rich person, but now it is very useful to the industry, and these washers are actually patented and it is expensive to get these washers also. So these are squat washers. The reason why I'm telling you that these squat washers will work only when the surface is flat. If you have a tapered flange, you will not be able to take advantage of these squat washers, and hence your the time that is required to complete the project is increasing. Not only the time, but the quality is also sacrificed. So if you have a flat or a parallel flange, you can take advantage of the squat washers and increase your time, and the efficiency as well as the reliability of the project increases. So with this one, I will stop talking and I will let you ask any questions. So thank you for bearing with me. Anybody have any questions? Hungry?
Sir, I would like to know, like, whether these kind of parallel flange beams have been used in steel concrete composite construction?
Steel construction, has it been used?
I mean, steel concrete composite beams. Whether these type of parallel flange beams have been used, sir? Like, when you have a steel.
Yeah. There is no reason why they should not use it. Okay. Whether they have actually been used in India, we don't know. But for a fact that Bell Trichy, I know for a fact, they were in discussions with JSPL to use parallel flange beams. So a lot of these have now been used. But whether they have used in composite structures, steel concrete composite structures, something I don't know. But there should not be any change. It's just a change in the geometry.
Okay.
There should not be any change in terms of application wise. In fact, it would be much better to use parallel flange beams.
And whatever the design curves you have shown for various sections, so whether all those sections come under plastic sections, sir?
No, plastic or this thing depends upon your section classification, as I told you. So you have to take the depth of the member and divided by the thickness of the web, and the width of the member divided by the thickness. So you have to, using the table 2 of IS 800, I think there are certain classifications.
Yes.
So you can use that and you can classify that. Okay, so so based on this, you can classify the cross-section as plastic, compact, semi-compact or slender. Okay, slenderness usually doesn't come in this category. It is plastic, compact and semi-compact. But regardless, for the equivalent section, your parallel flange beams will have much higher load carrying capacity. Any questions from students? There's no such thing as stupid question. You are welcome to ask anything. Okay.
So we have one question in the chat box.
Okay.
From faculty. The question is that should the geometry of the rails in the railway track also has to be changed?
The railway track has a different geometry, na? There's a head, a heavy head, and that track is very different. They have a heavy head, and then it's not a parallel flange, it's not an high section. Okay, it's certainly not a high section. The sections that are used for railway tracks have a much different cross section, very specifically for railway. Okay, though they are not parallel branches. This is mainly for infrastructure segments, buildings, bridges, and other places.
So we have another question also. Parallel flange beam, is there any restricted maximum depth? In maximum depth, is there any restrictions?
No, there is no restriction. See, the availability, your ability to produce. Say, for example, your ISMB is restricted to 600, right? That is our limitation, but parallel flanges beams can be produced up to 900 mm. It is being produced by Jindal Steel and Power Limited, JSPL. So JSPL has up to 900 mm. But if you want to use the 900 mm in a project, okay, you should give them enough notice period. So you should at least work with them for 6 months before, so that they will arrange their mill, and there is a minimum mill quantity that you have to promise. They will not give one or two sections for 900 mm, because they have to change the mill and other things. So if it is a big project and you can take advantage of that, you start working with them early, 6 months to 1 year before the thing, during the design phase itself. So don't complete the design and go to them and ask certain things. If you work with them in the design phase itself, they will tell you that these sections are possible, and up to 900 mm they have produced parallel flange steel sections, which means that there is a tremendous increase in your load carrying capacity. Not to mention that your hot rolled steel sections will have a higher capacity compared to welded steel sections, right? You know that, right? The classification, curve classification ABCD is there, right? IS 800, four curves ABCD. So A is better than B, B is better than C, and C is better than D, right? So A is better than B. If everything is same, if you are having a rolled steel section, you can choose curve A, and if everything is same, and if you have a welded steel section, you have to choose B, right? Simply because you have more residual stresses in during welding, so which is very less in rolled steel sections. The residual stresses may be around 8 to 10% for a rolled steel section. Maybe it is 33% of your yield stress when it comes to welded steel sections. So obviously, the code will penalize you for using welded steel sections by asking you to choose a lesser curve, the next lower curve. Okay, so in such situations, if you have to go for a welded steel section for 900 mm, and if you are going to get a parallel flange steel section for 900 mm, it is almost always advisable to go for a 900 mm deep parallel flange rolled steel sections. But for that, you need to work with those people to get the desired sections. Did I answer your question? Questions?
Any questions from students?
This is the time to ask questions. Most of the final year students would have completed steel design, I believe. I'll tell you one thing. If you're not going to talk, you'll have a tough time in civil engineering. Okay. Civil engineering is more than 50-60% is communication. 10-20% is actual technical work when you go to a job. Okay, you should be able to communicate effectively. Communication is key. And it is very important that you communicate effectively. So don't hesitate to ask questions.
I think most of the audience are from third year only, and a few first year and second year students are there.
Okay.
I can see a few final year students. Because the third year students, they are studying RC. Next semester they will be studying steel. They don't have much idea on that. Okay.
Oh, I see. Okay. Good. Any more questions from the faculty?
So if no questions, I request Neha to give a vote of thanks. Is that fine?
And I have a question, sir. Like in the conventional sections, like I have come across the castellated beams, that the beams had openings. And whether there is any difference in that in parallel flange beams, whether we can have such type of
The castellated beams are just for service to use in other things. So castellated beams, you know, only thing is the depth should not be more than, the depth of the opening should not be more than 50% of the depth of the web. That is more like a, you know, a bounding criteria. Other than that, the parallel flanges will deal only with the flanges. So if the openings are going to be in the depth, I don't see any problem with that. Okay, castellated beams, you should take into account the reduction in shear capacity because of the loss of the strength at that location.
Okay.
But this will be nice in a way because it will also increase, decreases the height for the same depth, because one is 300, one is 200, you have a saving of 100 mm if you go for the parallel flange steel sections. But it is only in India we have this tapered
flange. Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Nobody, nowhere else in the world you will have a tapered flange section. So it's not an innovation. It's simply that we have not adapted ourselves to the changing world.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
It's a great learning for all of us. Today's session topic is new for us. We have gained knowledge on parallel flange beams. Thank you once again. Every great start has its end. Now, I call Ms. Neha to deliver the oath of thanks.
Warm greetings to the respected guest speaker of the session, respected HOD, faculties of civil and other departments of SVCE, and my dear friends. I am Neha from second year civil engineering. It's an honor and privilege to extend vote of thanks on this occasion. On behalf of the Department of Civil Engineering, I would like to thank our guest speaker, Dr. Mahendra Kumar Madhavan, for taking his precious time out and consenting to be this guest speaker. Sir, indeed, your lecture was thought-provoking. We have been fortunate enough to be backed up by our beloved head of the department, Professor R. Kumuda. She has been a constant moral support and guidance. I extend my sincere thanks to the civil department faculties and supporting staffs for their enormous support and cooperation. A special thanks to our department association staff in charges, R. Kalevanan and S. Harishwaran, for their constant motivation and efforts. I thank all the office bearers of the association who have been great helping hands. Last but not the least, I thank all the students for showing their interest in the program. Thank you all. Let's meet on another good occasion.
Thank you very much. I have one message for all of you. Madam, can I speak for a couple of minutes?
Yes, sir. Yes, of course.
Okay. I would like to tell you that there are many great opportunities to pursue your higher education at IIT Hyderabad. Yeah, IIT Hyderabad is one of the new and upcoming IITs. It has been in the scene for more than 10-12 years. So those who have really a passion towards research are welcome to apply at IIT Hyderabad. You know, the only requirement is you should do well in your GATE. Okay, so I request everyone to consider IIT Hyderabad as your choice of destination for higher studies. Okay, we have fantastic lab facilities, one of the state of the art. We have a 600 plus acre campus. It's very safe for everybody inside the campus. We have 24/7 security, separate hostel for girls, state of the art facilities. Each student gets an individual room, good mess facilities. Okay, a nice place, playground, everything that you need is very good here at IIT Hyderabad. So when you are completing your undergraduate education and are interested in pursuing higher education, okay, there are a lot of great opportunities for you to pursue at IIT Hyderabad. I work in the area of steel structures, okay, steel and steel concrete composite structures, core form steel structures. So everybody, anybody, who, any student who has a passion towards these areas are welcome to contact me, okay, and I am interested in hiring good quality students, even if they have completed just the BTEC and are interested in pursuing the PhD, I would be very happy to guide them. Okay, we have a direct PhD program at IIT Hyderabad. So direct PhD program, you will get both your master's and PhD in a span of five and a half years. So you will get both master's and PhD, which is a great thing if you want to take up a career in teaching and research, which is a very lucrative profession as well. Civil engineering is one of those professions where you can make money all your life. So if you know what you're doing, it is a very good. And there are a lot more opportunities to be faculty members if you're really good and have accomplished good quality research. So I request people who have passion to directly get in touch with me, okay, and spread this message. My email is mkm, Mahendra Kumar Madhavan, so mkm at cecivilengineering.iith, so IIT Hyderabad, .ac.im. Okay, so you're welcome to get in touch with me and I would be glad to help you out. There is also something called the Prime Minister's Research Fellowship is also there for people who are very good, but that is currently restricted, I believe, to IITs and NITs. But once you come into the system and you're about to complete 1 or 2 years and we can give you a master's degree and you can apply for Prime Minister's Fellowship. That fellowship is like 70,000 rupees per month and for the first 1 or 2 years, and then 80,000 rupees for the remaining 3 years. These are all good opportunities for you to take this one and then become, take this opportunity and move forward in life. So I extend a warm welcome to people, interested people to come and pursue higher education at IIT Hyderabad. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir, for providing more insights on the higher education opportunities in IIT. And also, I'd like to add some more points here because our students are always enthusiastic. And I mean, 2016-20 back students and two of our students were qualified in GATE. I don't know whether they're interested in higher studies. I mean, let me ask them. And suppose if they're interested, definitely I will ask them to contact you, sir.
Sure.
And at present, the final year students also, they're appearing for GATE and they're preparing for GATE. I think we can focus them on those aspects and we can encourage them in pursuing higher studies. And I will let you know soon, sir, on this particular aspect.
Sure, ma'am. Sure, ma'am. Because this is, SVC is one of the great colleges. It has been in existence for close to 25 years, I believe. 35. So it has been one of the very good colleges, very well established. So I'm sure everything is in good place and we would really like to welcome you and take great opportunities. And IIT Hyderabad is unique in many ways. Okay, we don't follow very much of hierarchy. Basically, we all, just work. That's it. There's no much hierarchy compared to other established IITs. So your experience at IIT Hyderabad would be fantastic. So I would request you to strongly consider IIT Hyderabad as your choice destination for higher education.
Yeah, of course. Yes, Mr. Kalaivanan, I think you can proceed with anything else is there as per the agenda.
That's all, ma'am, I think, from my side. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much, madam. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. Yeah, thank you, sir.
Thank you.